Star have been nominated for the Critics' Choice Independent Spirit and Golden Globe Awards. Please join me in welcoming writer and director Céline Sciamma and cinematographer Claire Mathon. Congratulations on a beautiful movie. Whenever I have someone as accomplished as you both are, I actually like to go back to the beginning. And what was your first job in this business? The first time you felt you could call yourself a director or a VP, sorry, cinematographer, I should say.
Want me to start? Well, I was lucky enough to consider myself a director when I directed a film. Which I did pretty early, because I wrote my first original script at the film school, and I shot this film as my first feature film, which was once released.
That was your first film? You didn't do a short or anything like that?
No.
Wow.
So it's kind of unusual, and I just discovered my job doing it, and also discovered that I loved it very much. So I'm a very good example of
That's a great example. That's
yeah.
The way it should be done. Claire, what about for you?
It takes a little bit more time to be a cinematographer. I was pretty young. I have done my first film as a cinematographer in 2006. And I'm pretty young, so I was pretty young.
Was it a feature film?
Yes,
it was my first feature film.
It's called Pardonnez-moi, Forgive Me.
Oh, okay, cool. Has it come out over here? Do you know? Can you find it?
It's a film made by Mai Wen, who made Police also, who made Yang, who was in the country as well. So I'm sure you can. It's a first feature.
Oh, wow, that sounds great. So getting to A Portrait of a Lady on Fire, I know we've seen films before where male artists sort of reflect on a woman who inspired them, but I feel like this is something really unique. And I'm curious, what was the initial spark for the idea of this film? Was it an image? Was it a line? Was it a story?
Well, first it was a whole concept, a very simple, candid concept of I want to write a love story and I want to dedicate a film to love. Because I feel it's the film that hits us the most, but there are very few that are actually getting made, you know. So I wanted to dedicate a film to love. And then there were some images, sometimes a line, sometimes like images like the character will be set on fire, a line like don't we guys remember a beach in Brittany and it would be grey if it was sunny. So this shit happens. As long as you welcome it with a talented person by your side, it's good news. So then for several years, I must say, I gathered impression, desire, not trying to be too mechanical about storytelling, not thinking too much about the plot, but thinking about building an architecture of desire. And then from that, building a plot so that the film would be full of very needed, wanted images so that then I could hand my desire to my collaborators so that they would take care of it with their own desire.
And Claire, you're having an amazing year. She was named Best Director of Photography by LAFCA, which is why she's in town, so we should be glad that they brought her out here. Not just for this movie, but for Atlantis. Which we have seen is on Netflix now and is beautiful. What attracted you to this project specifically?
Now I get to know.
same. When I read the script, I was very touched, sure that it's full of sensitivity and I was very, very touched. I read the script, for sure, and I feel it's it's a world to create. It's not only because there's many links with painting, of course, but it's really a new territory. It's new images to imagine, and it feels wow. No, it's very rare to be able to read that kind of script.
I'm curious, just because it's right behind us, we have this stunning image here. Is that something that like came into your head and then you had to put it into words? And you know, was that, I don't know if you read the script, but you must have had conversations about not just how you would pull this off, but what it looked like here. Is this exactly as you imagined it?
No, because I mean, cinema is ideas. So of course you imagine ideas, but it's like it's. I think it's appetite for images, but it's not about fetishizing something that hasn't been done yet. So I can't say it's what I had. I didn't have that image in mind. I had the idea of actually setting the character on fire, and that. There was a compass, there was an ambition. And of course I knew that it was a bell, so I could imagine. Actually, you know, setting somebody on fire is not something you can imagine.
Yeah.
You know. So that's what I love about cinema, is that you can be really radical with your desire and your ideas, but still, it's about the work you're gonna put up together, and then at some point it's about the present. So you get to enjoy all the pleasure of this, the anticipation and the desire for an image, and at some point it happens, and it's not about an accident, it's something that has been planned, but still it's full of life. So you can't anticipate it's going to look like that, but you can dream about it so much and still get surprised. That's the beauty of this job, I think.
This movie is set in the 1700s, but obviously it feels way too current in so many ways. Did you always know it would be a period piece?
Well, yes, because I wanted to talk about the art of portrayal, and that's all about. I didn't want to talk about cinema. I wanted to talk about cinema, obviously, but I didn't want to front to be about cinema. And the art of portrayal has a lot to do with this time period. And also, I wanted to show an artist at work, really at work with concrete actions. You know, so usually in cinema we get to choose people who write literature, because it's easy to do. So I wanted to go deep into this and show somebody at work, and so that it wouldn't be about the final art. You know, we don't care about the painting in a way. Like when it's done, we're not even kind of looking at it. Only that she looks at it when it's done, and it's just, and so, but to us it's not about, oh, is this beautiful? It's about, oh shit, this story is over.
Yeah.
So to look at somebody at work, that was, and so painting seemed perfect for that. And then I chose that particular moment really about, because it's about art history, because portrait was higher at that moment, also because of the rise of bourgeoisie that led to the French Revolution, and also because there was a lot of women painters at that time, hundreds of them, and I was totally ignorant about that, because we all are, because they are all being erased from art history. So when I learned about this, I was like, oh, this has to be precisely at that moment. You may have to be really accurate about this when we work with a sociologist of the art, actually. Create this character to represent them all.
Yeah. Claire, I read a great interview where you said that you sort of wanted to create your own 18th century and give it a contemporary resonance. How did you go about achieving that? I mean, I think when you see it, it's obvious, but how did you set out to make that happen?
We imagine it, but no, it was the main, I think it was one of the main question of the image. It's how to find the good balance between epoch, souvenir, the mind, and saying about the film, what is important is a presence, its incarnation for today. We have to be in with her, in the film. It's more important to be it's present, it's kind of the present of this epoch, and the main difficult things to find was the balance between epoch and present.
Earlier you mentioned Adele, who plays Pelopes, who I know you've worked with, I believe, twice before?
This once.
Oh, okay. We've done three films together for some reason.
No.
Did you write it with her in mind?
Oh, yes. I wrote it with her in mind, definitely.
And then she has such amazing chemistry with Naibi. I'm curious.
I want the chemistry, too.
Did you?
Yeah, they don't get along.
Did they ever, like, screen test together, or did you just know that it worked?
No, they didn't screen test together. I met Noemi in the process of casting, and I met her by myself first with the casting director. And I was giving her the line. So I was the model and she was the painter. So we were already playing with this cool power dynamic, you know. So it was like, and she was like, she made a very strong impression on me, but it's definitely, we call her back.
Yeah.
And also with Adele, and that's definitely one. I saw the two of them in the frame, but like my heart was racing because it felt like this is new.
Mm.
Of course, because this chemistry is new. Yeah, this, and at that moment, I totally understood what I was looking for. That's what the process of casting is also. It's not only about finding the right person. It's about understanding what you're looking for. And they had this strong sense of equality at the same height, which is really important in cinema, otherwise you wouldn't put metal boxes, but they're smaller than at the same age. Strong physical contrast that created this iconic duo. Very big intensity. You know, it's like, oh, this equality is full of surprise. Like, I don't know what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
New tension in the room that is not based on, that is based on this harmony. And like, really, I didn't even look at my casting director. Like, I cut the camera because I was filming very badly. And I got to know that this is for you. It was obvious. Yeah, and I'm not a more romantic person, as you can see.
The film
is a slow burn, and it's definitely built around around the rise of desire. Yes, it's about love, but it takes the time to look at desire, which is something that is rarely filmed, you know, what it's like to film desire. So, but I didn't know, I mean, so the rhythm is about the different steps. It's about the delay you decide that you're going to take they kiss after 1 hour and 20 minutes. That's a good way to see it. So taking all these steps. So it was really carefully written, but then the rhythm we definitely created on the set. And the fact that those gazes were, I mean, I felt passionate about them. I was like, oh, this is strong tension.
Yeah.
And so the film, because the film is very, it has only 69 scenes, which is, it's not much. And the script was only 19 pages, which means actually an hour and a half. But after like 2 weeks of shooting, we knew it would be like 2 hours long.
Because
we were enjoying this rhythm. And also because we wanted to create that rhythm. We're not being enslaved to the performance of the actresses. We are definitely creating this melody together. And it felt right to be, patient and to believe in also at some point the rush of blood that the film would go faster in a weird way.
Everything that went into it,
So the art magazine, I think, comes at first from this, because I had this idea of setting the character on fire and then also setting the title on fire as a compass, as an ambition, not to be too metaphorical, but to embody actually passion. So at some point I was like, okay, so she has to be set on fire. So how can we make this epic and not just like we're in the kitchen and like I got fire? And I thought, oh, this would be, there should be a big fire, and so maybe it could be a gathering. And I was like, ah, anyway, I want to talk a little bit about witches, because, you know, I want to convoke the fact that, I want to tell about the fact that witches were actually wise women, botanists, doctors, hanging around. There was a fire because, you know what, they hang around outside and it was cold. It's like a party, you know, to embody friendship, the fact that they would fly would mean that they would get high. All that we know about witches, all that they decided to burn, that's what they decided to burn. So I wanted to make this very naturalistic scene about witches, but also to convoke the imaginary within witches, so the song would embody that. And also even the song would be, because we played it live, but then we decided to mix it with this tape within the studio so that it would become not naturalistic at all. But regarding what we did with the image, we really decided to make it naturalistic and very modest in a way. It's only 6 shots, I think.
Wow.
And all the shots we did, they are in there, you know, the editing is like really modest, and we were modest about this. It's like, they arrive, it's a long take, you see the extras, and it's like, oh, well, this is a party. Then it's shot, reverse shot. Mm-hmm. And also shot, reverse shot, they smile at each other for the first time. Yes, we resisted that urge. And then she's just on fire, that's the 6th shot, and then there's this very weird cut between the 2 scenes that was written. So we basically just shot what we decided that we would, which is, I mean, I don't know if it's good news, but you can make an epic. We had a strong ambition for that scene, but it's only like very few shots, very few takes that are modest. And it's also combining all the tools of cinema, because this has a lot to do with image, the special effects that we do like they would have done 100 years ago. You know, she actually setting the actress on fire. That's also very modest in a way. It's dangerous, but modesty can be really dangerous. And also to craft a song, to invent a song, which I think is also very candid, you know, to take that risk, you know, to create the anthem for your film. So this has been a scene that we knew it was at the center of everything, but still it's totally different from, I mean, it's isolated, and it's a turning point, because after that, things will never be the same. And even the pace of the film is changing after that. Like suddenly, it's a rush.
Yeah.
Like I know, because I've been watching a lot of the ending of the film, and like, those last 40 minutes, they feel like 20, whereas the last, the previous hour and a half felt like 4. Well, I don't want to give lessons, you know. But still, we're making political cinema. Because cinema is always political, you know. But we are activists for cinema. And when you make a film about love, you're producing, you're telling something that is very democratic, because we are all looking for that. So basically, really wanting to present also the lesbian imaginary, a different power dynamic, a different kind of relationship. And also departing from the idea that, you know, it's either a tragic love story or a frozen image of two people living in a car, just married, and then in hands. One is dramatic, the other one, you live in the room. You're not taking it at home with you. The frozen image of the two people getting married doesn't help you at all to go through life. And the other one hurts you. So, yeah. Trying to depart from those two things and really thinking that a love story is complete if it gives you emancipation. So it's not about eternal possession or eternal not being together. Trying to bring a new politics of love on screen. So what I want you to take, I want you to feel free within that imaginary, to feel welcome. And mostly I want you to connect with yourselves, which is also modest. In a way, you know, it's not about understanding messages here. I'm focusing on experiment, and it's a prototype. But you know, prototypes sometimes they become, I mean, at some point, you know, the iPhone was a prototype.
What I would love is if you could all spread the word about this movie and let people know that it's in theaters now and they can check it out. You will be at the LA Film Critics Awards tomorrow. I already know you've won, so that's gotta be nice.
Got the winner.